Hello and welcome to Your Library at Home. My name is Sam Hagen and I manage the library's public programming team. I'd like to begin this evening by acknowledging that we meet on country. I live and work on Gadigal land and I'd like to take this opportunity to pay my respects to elders past, present and especially emerging. I also extend that respect to any Aboriginal Australians who may be joining us this evening. Welcome. Welcome to the latest in the library series of online author talks. We're getting quite used to seeing you all here, and hopefully you're also visiting the library website regularly to keep an eye on what's coming up. But tonight we're in for a really special treat. The library has partnered with the Korean Cultural Centre to present this special Korean book club event. The Korean Cultural Centre is a gateway into Korean culture in Sydney. They offer a whole heap of things, including language classes, exhibitions, and sometimes even K-pop dance classes, which I'm sure many of you would love to attend, after COVID, that is. For tonight's event, we'd really like to thank author Cho Nam-Joo and publishers Mia Musa and Simon and Schuster for their help in getting this event together. Tonight's talk focuses on the wildly popular Korean book, Kim Jiyoung, Born 1982, written by Cho Nam-Joo. I believe we even have a message from the author herself, which will be read by one of tonight's guests, Dr. Jane Park, who will be on your screen shortly. But for now, I'd like to introduce Michaela Kalowski, who'll be leading our discussion. Michaela will be known to library regulars, but for those who haven't had the pleasure, Michaela is an interviewer, facilitator, and presenter. She's also presented programs and conducted interviews for ABC Radio, local radio, and Classic FM. And in June of this year, she curated the ABC Radio National's first ever on-air writers' festival, the Big Weekend of Books. So she's very highly qualified to lead tonight's talk. I'm going to hand over to her. Michaela, are you with me?
Hello, Sam. Thank you very much for that invitation. As Sam said, my name is Michaela Kalowski, and it's my absolute pleasure to be here tonight. As Sam just explained to you, tonight's conversation will centre around the novel Kim Jiyoung, Born 1982, by Cho Nam-Joo. It caused a massive stir in South Korea after its publication, and it sold a million copies. It's also been translated into 12 languages. In 2019, it was turned into a film that also caused an uproar. People petitioned the president of South Korea to stop the film being made. It's a chronicle of the day-to-day sexism and discrimination that Kim Jiyoung lives with as a girl, as a woman, as a wife, as a worker, and as a mother in South Korea. And the novel charts her spiral into depression, maybe madness. But is it madness, or is it an appropriate response to a life that is very challenging? To talk about the book and its impact, and to offer some insights about South Korea and women's lives and experiences, we're joined tonight by Dr. Jane Park, and I want to tell you first a bit about her before we get going. Dr. Jane Chi-Yun Park is a senior lecturer in the Department of Gender and Cultural Studies at the University of Sydney. Her research explores the impact of popular culture on changing ideas of race and gender, with a focus on how East Asian and Asian diaspora identities and cultures are represented in the media. So she's the perfect person to speak to us about this book. She recently spearheaded the development of the diversity minor at the University of Sydney, and she's the co-coordinator of the Race and Diversity Research Network. She's published really widely in a range of journals, as well as anthologies on film, media, and popular culture. Her monograph, Yellow Future, Oriental Style in Hollywood Cinema, was published in 2010, and it explored the growing popularity of East Asian bodies and styles in Hollywood films from the 1980s to the early 2000s. She's currently working on a second book about representations of Korean and Korean diasporic femininity in global popular culture. I wanted to say as well that Jane's comments are her own. We're not pretending that she's the sole expert on South Korea, but she is part of the South Korean diaspora, and along with her body of work, and she's extremely well-placed to share with us her insights about the book and about the ability of popular culture to shape our ideas of race and gender and about South Korea. Welcome to Jane. Are you there, Jane?
Yes, I am. Thank you, Michaela. I also want to just acknowledge that I'm coming to you from the land of the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation, and I would like to pay my respects to their elders past, present, and emerging. I also want to thank David Park and Minji Chung, who invited me to do this. I actually was there when the Korean Cultural Center was being built many, many years ago. And I participated in a few events in the past for the film festival and other things. So it's really lovely to be back and to be addressing that audience. And also I wanted to thank Sam Hagen and Jada McLaughlin for all the work that they've done in organizing this on behalf of the State Library. And of course, Michaela, it's been lovely getting to know you a little bit. So I thought I would begin with a letter that the author, Cho Nam-Joo, sent us. And I'm going to do a very Korean Asian thing and also a very female thing by apologizing. So I'm Korean American. I was born in South Korea and then we moved to the US when I was 4. So I'm fluent enough in Korean that I can have an informal conversation and order things. But I'm also quite tired. So I am not able to read this to you in the original Korean. So my apologies to everybody who is Korean in the audience. This is the English translation. Author's greetings from Cho Nam-Joo. It has been 5 years since I wrote Kim Jiyoung, born 1982. The novel was written during the autumn and winter of 2015 and published in autumn of 2016. Since then, 3 more books of mine have been released. So to me, this is a book that seems to dwell in the past. Nonetheless, I've had numerous occasions to continue thinking and speaking about Kim Jiyoung. Especially since the publication of its translations, I have had many opportunities to be interviewed by foreign media and to write articles about the book for overseas readers. I often wonder what remains of the world that I lived in and my thoughts at the time that I wrote this novel. There were moments when it seemed everything was changing, when I was stuck, and even when my life went backwards for a while. To be honest, I remain a skeptical person, but knowing there are people reading this novel in my city and elsewhere gives me strength. My book is braver than I am. I hope it will travel to places I have not been able to. I hope it will give courage to my readers.
Thank you for that. And I should say the way that tonight's conversation will go is that Jane and I will speak for about 40 minutes and we're going to leave a good 15 minutes for your questions at the end. So feel free to pop them in the Q&A box and we'll get to as many of them as we can. Keep them in your mind as we're going along. But I wanted to start, if we can, Jane, by focusing on the book before we dive in and pull it apart. Could you give us a little bit of a synopsis of who Kim Jiyoung is and what happens to her? What's at the center of this book?
So here's the book. I love the cover, it's bright yellow, and you have a picture of a woman whose face you don't see. And I think that sums up a lot of, it's a really lovely cover to sort of sum up the universality, I think, of this character. Certainly for Korean women, and now with the popularity globally, it seems to have resonated with women all over the world. So the book is a very slim novel. And it's written in this quite clinical style, and I won't give away the sort of twist at the end when you sort of figure out why it's written in that way. And it's basically, so it begins, I feel like I'm back teaching literature classes. It begins with a sort of scene from the present time, which is 2016. Actually, no, it's autumn 2015. She's 33 years old, or 34 in Korean age. I'll just read you a little bit. I'll read you the beginning.
Just to, love it, just to give people a taste.
Yeah, autumn 2015. Kim Jiyoung is 33 years old or 34 in Korean age. And I'll give you a little bit of quick explanation, cultural explanation. So in Korea, as soon as you're born, you're already 1 year old. So we always say Korean age, I'm not even gonna tell you how old I am, but anyway, Korean age, I'm always a year older than I am in Western age.
Thank you.
She got married 3 years ago and had a daughter last year. She rents a small apartment on the outskirts of Seoul with her husband, Jung Dae-hyun, 36, and daughter, Jung Ji-won. Dae-hyun works at a mid-sized IT company, and Ji-young used to work at a small marketing agency, which she left a few weeks before her due date. Dae-hyun usually comes home from work around midnight and goes into the office at least once on weekends. Dae-hyun's parents live in Busan, and Ji-young's parents run a restaurant, making Ji-young her daughter's sole carer. Just after Jiwon turned one in the summer, she started daycare as a half-day infant. She spends her mornings at a converted ground floor apartment daycare center in the same apartment complex where she lives. Jiyoung's abnormal behavior was first detected on 8 September. Taehyun remembers the exact date because it was the morning of Baengno, which means white dew in Korean, the first night of autumn when the temperature drops below dew point. Taehyun was having toast and milk for breakfast when Jiyoung suddenly went to the veranda and opened the window. It was quite sunny out, but the cold air rushed in as soon as the window was opened and reached the kitchen table where Taehyun was sitting. I could go on. Anyway, so they have this conversation and Jiyoung starts speaking in this very, very strange way. And her husband is kind of alarmed. So Taehyun laughed at his wife, who was talking like a much older woman. "What's up with you? You sound like your mom. Take a light jacket with you. Jeong sobang. There's a chill in the mornings and evenings. I wish I could do this in Korean." Anyway, so then he thought she was just joking around. Her imitation of her mother was flawless, down to her signature right eye wink when she was asking for a favor and the elongated last syllable of Jeong sobang. He found her staring off into space or crying over sad songs, but Taehyun figured she was just exhausted from taking care of the baby. She was basically a cheerful person, full of laughter, who often made Taehyun laugh by doing impressions of celebrities. So Taehyun shrugged off Jiyoung's imitation of her mother, gave her a hug, and went to work. When Taehyun came back from work that night, she was sleeping next to their daughter. Both were sucking their thumbs, looking cute but absurd. Gazing at the two side by side, he tugged at his wife's arm to pull her thumb out of her mouth. Jiyoung's tongue stuck out a little and she smacked her lips just like a baby and then settled back into sleep. So that's the first two pages or so. And it gives you a sense of Jiyoung's kind of, I suppose, descent into madness, right? Or depression or something. So her particular condition is she starts then in that opening, they then take a trip to Taehyun's family. So her husband's family and for, I think it's Chuseok for the holidays. And she starts again, imitating somebody else. And so basically, you know, embarrassing her husband and so on. So that it starts like that, and then it flashes back and you get this really pithy, clinical, objective sounding kind of narrative, linear narrative of her life from childhood all the way to the point at the beginning of the novel. So it's childhood, adolescence, early adulthood, marriage. So this is a very sort of conventional narrative of womanhood, right? That certainly in South Korea, and I think, and in Australia as well, that many women are expected to follow. I could go on and on, but yeah.
I think for people who haven't read the book yet, and it's fantastic, it's, you know, it's very slim, but it's very powerfully concise. It also, in all those epochs of her life, it details the ways that she's excluded for being a girl, that her brother gets his own room when she and her sister and grandmother share, that her brother then gets to go to school when her sister doesn't, that she's harassed on at every strata of society, whether it's public or private. So in her own family or in the classroom, as a girl, as a young woman, as a worker, she's set upon, she's harassed, she's belittled, she's expected less of or more of. There's this very interesting vibe that goes all the way through the book where it's almost as if women like her are treated the same, that the expectation is that they should do the same as men, they should work as hard as men. But at the same time, the expectation on what they should do as women is just as great. So it's that thing where treating people who are different the same doesn't lead to any kind of equality. But the book is not didactic at all. It does, as you said, it's got this very linear structure, but it's got a strange, almost reportage style, where at the bottom of some pages there's a footnote, and it footnote references when a gender diversity commission was set up or when a law changed in South Korea. But you know, it really does detail by halfway or by 20 pages into the book, I was saying whoa out loud. I didn't understand the level at which women were excluded from some things in life in South Korea, and that's not necessarily different to in other places. But I suppose I was taken aback by the level at which every aspect of Kim's life is shaped by her gender. It's shaped by the fact that she's a girl or a woman. And I wondered if you could reflect for us why this book caused such a stir in South Korea and whether you felt like it was a genuine reflection of what life is like in South Korea for a woman.
It's a good question. And it's one that I'm not sure I'm qualified to answer. because again, I didn't grow up in Korea. So I'm speaking to all of you and to you, Michaela, as, you know, Korean American who's been living in Australia for 12 years, but this is, how do I say this? I've gotten this from my mother. I've gotten this through my friends who are Korean, who grew up there, you know, my aunties. So it's not like this is an experience that I've necessarily had. Actually, that's not true. I lived in Korea for a while. So I did experience this in some ways, but again, differently because of my sort of westernized background. Mm. I guess I could start just by saying that, you know, it's interesting how Me Too exploded all over the world. It sort of started in the US and it was expressed through all of these famous celebrities, you know, talking about getting groped by Harvey Weinstein. And in Korea, this book, Kim Jiyoung, along with other books by female authors, feminist authors, has sort of been taken up as a manifesto of the movement, of the expression of the Me Too movement in Korea, which I suppose kind of came into being in 2016, in spring of 2016. And what sparked it there was not a celebrity situation, although there have been many sexual harassment scandals with female celebrities. And this is the sexism and the harassment in the entertainment industry is extremely pervasive. And I mean, but what sparked it was a young man in his 30s who, I suppose, in sort of the language that we know is what could be labeled an incel, you know, an involuntary celibate, sort of that movement of young misogynistic men who hate women and who think women have victimized them. He went into a public toilet in a suburb in Seoul and just stabbed a woman to death, a woman he didn't even know. So this then became this huge kind of national news piece. And, you know, a lot of folks, men said this is a mental health issue. It has nothing to do with gender. And this is when a lot of prominent women, academics, lawyers, you know, thinkers came out and said, activists said, no, actually it's connected, right? That what we see an extreme expression of misogyny that certainly is linked to this individual's mental health, but it also speaks to a larger sort of mental health issue that's linked to societal injustice, you know, in South Korea, which is precisely what you were gesturing toward, Michaela, about that everything in this book, it has to do with sort of her role as a woman and how that dictates just how she moves in spaces, opportunities she gets. And I suppose more insidiously, not just very explicit modes of sexism like sexual harassment at work, but within intimate relationships, within her own marriage, the ways that her husband is extremely loving. You know, he's a fantastic guy. He helps out with the housework, you know, for instance, or helps change the diapers, you know. But the fact that that's seen as exceptional, and I bet a lot of women here who are, thank God I'm not married, no disrespect, but after reading this book, I was like, yay, single them. But the women who are married or who are in relationships, I'm sure can relate, you know, this kind of massive disparity. Women are expected to go out and work and be successful, but you're also expected to be successful as a mother. That's a huge part of this kind of cis heteronormative identity. And men just do not do their share of the work. I have lived with men, so I know. So you...
Even the language that you describe them, which is the language used in the book, which is helping out, the idea that there's women's work and then there's men helping out as if it's something extra or additional or lucky. Exactly. But I think one of the things I think the book did really brilliantly is it enunciates, again without being didactic, the invisible labor that women do, and not just in South. I mean, I think that what I found fascinating about it, and I wanted to ask you about it, is that it resonated with me here, and I'm in Sydney and I'm in Australia and I've not had the pleasure of being to Korea yet, but it seems to strike a chord with a lot of women. This has been translated, it's moved all around the world. So on the one hand, I want to talk to you about its Korean's specificness, but on the other hand, it seems to have reached into a corner of being able to describe for a lot of women what an experience is like, the expectations mm-hmm. around going to work and childcare, the expectations around when to get married and whose name the child will take, the expectations around labor, doing labor that's in effect invisible, that's unpaid. And I wonder as well, like, is this novel kind of unique in South Korea? Have there been other novels like it that I suppose I'm trying to understand a bit, and I'd love to hear your reflections on why it caused such a stir. You know, it seems in its own way, there's nothing very, it's not visceral, it's not terribly descriptive, it doesn't have moments of, you know, as you said, even the sexism, much of it seems innocuous, almost insidious, you know, subtle. Why do you think it caused such a stir in 2016 in South Korea? What did it set off for people?
I think it was precisely that. I think it's because it's a very concise, kind of almost anonymous, it's the everydayness of it. And I think that's what allowed women to identify with it. And to see these experiences, for instance, the fact that the brother gets the room, right? The bedroom, the one bedroom, or, you know, there's a poignant scene where in her childhood where Jiyoung comes home and, you know, I think her mother says, well, I wanted to be a teacher. And Jiyoung kind of laughs like, really? Like, well, you know, and she says, well, yeah, but I had to save money and put my older brother to school because that was expected. But that kind of, I think a lot of women, because you've sort of, how do you say, like normalized or naturalized this system, that patriarchy, to see it written out in such a clear way and in such a kind of everyday language, I think was what was unique about this book. At least that's what I've read and that's what I've heard from my friends. Go ahead.
I was gonna say, you said before, you know, you were born in Korea but grew up in America and you have a diaspora experience, but you mentioned before your mother was born in Korea and I think she lived in Korea for much of her life. What year was she born in Korea? And I wondered if you could talk a bit about what she's told you of what her experience was like of growing up in a woman then, as opposed to the way she raised you.
So my mother was born in 1951, and she grew up in the third largest city in Korea, Daegu, which is extremely conservative. It's like the Texas of, or the Brisbane, like Queensland or something, or, you know, her mother was my grandmother was incredibly competent. So this could take a while, but I'll try to shorten it. So essentially my grandmother was very much like, and my mother too, very much like the mother in Kim Jiyoung, the novel. So you have a very, very strong mother in this novel and you see her. So one of the things that happens during Kim Jiyoung's, you know, young adulthood is the economic crisis that hit Korea, what we called IMF. And actually I happened to be in Korea at the time working for feminist organizations. So this, you know, it was the economic recession hits Korea and many, many, many people lost their jobs, you know, and what's interesting is, you know, as in the past during the Korean War, other crises, it's often the women who have stepped up, right, in this kind of invisible labor, making money, doing real estate, you know, investing in things, doing kind of entrepreneurial work, right? My grandmother actually, my grandfather lost his job at the bank. He was quite educated and prestigious, and it was a prestigious job, but he lost it. And she ended up at one point, apparently, she owned all the buses in Daegu. Like she was hugely successful as a businesswoman and kind of scary grandma, actually. but she, you know, we also, the astrology in Korea, we have like a Chinese astrology, but there's Korean aspects. And she used to tell my mother that, you know, she had the Sajupaita, the fate of Syngman Rhee, right? The first president of South Korea. So it was like, if I had been born a man, look at what I could have done, right? But instead, all the credit goes to the husband, to the father, you know, to the patriarch. But what's really, really sad is that my grandmother totally internalized the system. And so my mother grew up in a household where she had to sacrifice so much for her brothers. The girls had, and again, I'm not saying all families were like this, it just happens to be my family history. So all the girls had to sit in one table, the men sat in another. The men were always served first. There's so many ways in which they just were not valued as much. So my mother grew up with this sort of thorn in her heart. And so she sort of made a decision when she was quite young that when she had children, she would never ever discriminate, and she hasn't. So I'm extremely grateful for that. Having said that, you know, there are lots of things that you can't take the culture out of you, and then you also transmit it to the children, right? So there are ways in which, I don't know if she'd call herself a feminist, but as outspoken, and she's quite, she's very different from a lot of Korean women her generation. but nonetheless, there are still values that she's internalized, I think. Sorry, I don't know if that answered your question.
No, it does. And I think it's invaluable and to hear a little bit about your own mother's experience and to hear how differently she made a choice in relation to you. You mentioned before that this book was sort of rolled up in the Me Too movement in South Korea, that it became kind of part of the rallying cry. Were there other, I suppose, cultural aspects, books, films, TV shows that fed into recognizing women's sense of frustration and anger at the way that they were being treated? If you could talk, could you talk about some of those?
Yeah, so from 2016 on, you do see more and more representations just, you know, within TV dramas, which are hugely popular in Korea, as some of you know, and in film, of different kinds of very strong transgressive women speaking back to men and so on. I'm totally blanking on actual titles and things, but
I remember in an earlier conversation we had before this event, you mentioned a fabulous book called The Vegetarian.
Oh yes, actually The Vegetarian it came out in 2007, but it was translated into English the same year as Kim Jiyoung came out in 2016. So that book sort of paved the way for kind of K-literature, I guess, or K-fiction. So all of this is sort of, I feel like it's kind of getting off topic a bit, but I think Korean popular culture and Korean culture in general has become so popular around the world in the past, 20 so years. So in some ways, you know, Kim Jiyoung, The Vegetarian is another book written by Han Gang, which focuses on a Korean woman kind of going insane. I hate to say these are the two, it's interesting, these are the two books that have done very well in the West. But I think that, you know, and it's not a trope, again, that's exclusive to East Asia or anything. You know, I think about Charlotte Perkins' The Yellow Wallpaper in English literature, or the idea of the mad woman in the attic. You know, I think, and then just in general, we don't call it madness, but the level of depression that a lot, and the chronic illnesses that women have, you know, in terms of dealing with kind of institutionalized sexism. But the question, I think, you know, about sort of this period and what happened, in popular culture, you're seeing more and more sort of, you know, women speaking out and so on. But just in youth culture and, you know, in media culture, you have, there have been a bunch of movements, like, you know, women have been protesting, and a couple of things that come to mind, you know, you had this thing called the Free the Corset movement, right? Escape the Corset movement. I don't know if people have heard of this, but one of the ways in which Korean women, they waste a lot of time having to be beautiful. So beauty is a kind of, it's a requirement in Korea for women. All the CVs that you send out, your resumes, have your photo on it. So this is another reason that plastic surgeries become so normalized, and makeup. In fact, you have to take makeup courses in high school. It's part of professionalization. That's how important it is. So you can see glimmers of that in this book, like, you know, in the scene where she goes on the job interview and they get asked, what would you do if an employer sexually harassed you? And the correct answer is figure out maybe where you're wearing something too provocative, right? So you're seeing particularly young women, millennials and younger, really, really fighting back in social media. So Escape the Corset, you have really violent, angry young women just like, I mean, I'm watching this going, oh my God, that's such expensive skincare, but, you know, like just with a hammer, saying, screw this. I don't need to do this to be a human being, to be validated. And you also, there's a term that's come out recently called Sampo generation, which means it's three things. And so the idea is you're gonna give up on three things as a young woman. And the three things are dating, marriage, and children, all of it. So you have a whole bunch of young women cutting their hair. Sometimes I feel like a pioneer of this movement in a joke, because I'm single, I have a dog, all I have to do is cut my hair. But basically, you know, this, why not? But so much of this is a response to a particular, it's not just this universal sexism that I think a lot of women all women, I would say, experience around the world, but the specific manifestations of it in South Korea, which have to do with sort of historical and cultural things. I think you were getting to the question, Michaela, and I kind of evaded it or something, but one example of this is, for instance, there's this horrible culture that's emerged in like the early 2000s, and they're really trying to phase it out, you know, creating laws to get rid of it. It's called molka, and molka is, it's chronicled in this book as well, but it's when primarily like 90-95% of, or even more, of molka happens where the men are perpetrating it and the women are the victims, but it's illegally videotaping or recording women doing everyday things that exposes them. Like, you could illegally film, you know, somebody having sex or women going to the bathroom, right? Rather toilets. And I think that, interestingly, it's to me, again, I'm not an expert in this, and other colleagues of mine have written much in-depth academic papers and studies, but so much of this is how quickly South Korea has developed, and particularly since the economic recession, you know, in 1997, one of the ways in which South Korea has really become a global power is by adopting the internet really quickly, more quickly than any other country. So, you know, every time I go visit Korea and come back, I'm like, oh my God, I miss the internet. It's so fast. It's like magic. And basically, life has gone online. So the disorientation that we might feel right now on Zoom, this is kind of, or just, you know, the convenience of living online is something that I think a lot of younger people have experienced since, you know, since they were born, some of them. So you see this kind of, I think social media has a tendency, it decontextualizes things, and it can make, it has a tendency to sort of lead to tribalism, right? And so I think that this is something that's hit Korea in a really extreme way, like a lot of trends hit Korea. So I think the combination of a culture that is Neo-Confucian, you know, we got Confucianism from China, but people have talked about how it became even more intense in South Korea because of the smallness and the homogeneity of the culture. And Neo-Confucianism is extremely sexist, right? Like, the one sort of proverb that would encapsulate the role of a good woman, or what you should be as a woman in Korea, is Hyunmo Yangcho, which translates to wise mother, good wife. You know, that is your role in life, is to be a wise mother or a good wife, even in
very narrow definition and description of what it means to be a good woman.
Yeah. And so, you know, this is why I don't know my grandmother's name, you know, because women, your name doesn't matter. It's whose son are you? I mean, sorry, whose mother are you? You know, whose wife are you? And in Korea, you know, certainly feminists, this doesn't apply, but for many, many women, when you start dating somebody, you call them oppa, which means, I know this sounds a little weirdly incestuous, but you call them oppa, which is big brother, right? Because everybody's a big happy family. Anyway, so, but then there's a saying, oppa becomes appa, and appa means father. So it's like your big brother, who is the guy you're dating, becomes the father of your child, you know? And so that I think kind of encapsulates something specifically Korean.
It's a very good description, because it shows you in those language expressions, it shows you how deeply ingrained that idea is. And I thank you for that, because it's an enormous question. I wanted to get you to speak a bit about the historical and cultural aspects of Korean society, of South Korean society, that lead to this kind of discrimination and sexism. I think one of the things the book does so well is it shows you in very tiny ways how patriarchal structures reinforce themselves, how systems of power reinforce themselves to make it sound, to make you feel like you're crazy if you question doing it in any other way. And it's interesting, when I wondered what the heritage of that is, because it's, you know, I think one of the powerful things about the book, as we said before, is that it's connected with women and with readers all over the world, but there's still something very uniquely Korean about it. And as there is with every culture that has, as all cultures do, patriarchy and sexism or exclusion on the basis of gender, it's powerful and useful to understand where the heritage of those comes from, because it always comes from somewhere. I also wanted to talk a bit about the way that Kim Jiyoung details in the book that women are, you know, they drop out of the workforce as she has to, or she decides she has to. They either drop out a lot right before they have children or just after they have children. And the statistics about when women can re-engage or whether they re-engage are very, very poor. And it seems as well from the footnotes in the book as well, we get a very strong sense that there's a very real impact on a country like South Korea of this kind, of this level of discrimination. There's a very real impact on the GDP. There's a very real impact on fertility rates. There's a very real impact on all these other measurables, not only economic or capitalist measurables. But I wondered if you could reflect a bit on that as well, because it seems almost banal to mention, but they're very, very big markers about this, the creep of this discrimination and the level at which it disrupts everything socially, because it seems to be really disrupting the society.
Yes, absolutely. I would say it's an extreme version of what we get in Australia as well, right? I mean, I suppose we really all should be looking to the Nordic countries from what I've read and seen in terms of things that seem to be very, very basic, like providing, you know, adequate maternity leave, you know, not discriminating against, because there's unconscious bias on the level of male employers and some women employers. When they get employees, they assume that women are going to get pregnant, and then, you know, and then they'll leave, and then, you know. So I think in Korea, again, I'm not an expert on this, but it seems to me, again, from listening to my friends, it's a bit more perhaps ingrained, and the level of the extent and the level and the normalization of sexual harassment, I think it's changing. I think the Me Too movement is having a really big role, and I think the current administration is trying to address it because it's an endemic problem. It's a huge problem. And like you say, Michaela, it has a huge impact on how, you know, how the health in so many ways of the country and the culture. And again, it's not just women, it's all connected, right? It's intersectional. So it has to do with the huge, like, widening gap between rich and poor that, you know, we see in a movie like Parasite, you know, that's another one, actually. It's very, very Korean. And yet, you know, I had friends in Australia going, no, I totally relate, because, you know, real estate, people being homeless, you know, so I think that, I'm sorry, I totally lost my train of thought. I've been teaching for 5 hours today, so
that's
I'm
a bit... Good train of thought. Well, I think all the little digressions we go into, but I actually want to bring a question back to some of your work. You know, your research really examines the impact of popular culture on changing ideas of race and gender. And I wondered if you could share with us your thoughts on how a novel like this shakes up the conversation around sexism and discrimination towards women and girls in South Korea.
Well, I think the fact that it exists and that we're having this conversation shows that not only has it made an impact in Korea, but it's making an impact around the world. So I think one of the wonderful things about the Me Too movement is how it's spread. I mean, you could almost teach a class on feminism and globalization just doing case studies of Me Too around the world, right? Because, right, you see the ways in which patriarchy gets expressed differently, and also, just as importantly, how women respond. You know, because that's the thing. I feel like, you know, the way that I describe this book, it almost feels like, oh, and it's really not like this. I feel like I need to sell this book in some way. It's not just like, oh, every day men, you know, it's, you also have beautiful, you know, scenes of women, random women and colleagues and female friends kind of resisting, you know, and managing and negotiating. And there are all kinds of different forms of resistance to this sort of, it's really a disease, isn't it? Patriarchy, you know, and the ways that women, the way that we internalize that and then we reproduce it, I think that needs to be talked about as well. And I think the book does a really good job of that. You know, how do we free ourselves from this? But in terms of my own research, look, I mean, it's interesting because I look at the ways that primarily people of Asian descent, but really people of color, that's an Americanism, but diverse people, people who are seen as minorities, you know, primarily because of their culture or the way that they present racially, how we get represented or don't get represented in the media. And so there's definitely a kind of social justice element to what I do, but I'm also really, really interested in, like, you know, my friends who are sociologists do that well. The reason I love books like Kim Jiyoung and the reason I study popular culture and film and television is because I think that, this is going to sound really cheesy. I think, but it's true. I think that seeing your own experience reflected and people who look like you reflected is very important in affirming your existence and your worth. But I also think it's just as important. And this is the other thing that I think films, media, art, popular culture has the power to do, books, since this is the library, you know, is giving people who don't necessarily come from that culture or have that experience. I hope men read this book and feel something, right? Because I think these are ways that we can really get intimately into somebody's mind and somebody's experience, and just for a little while, get to feel a little bit of what they feel. And I think that it might foster empathy, which is something we sorely need right now all around the world at this point in time. You know, if we want any of these divisions to kind of, I don't know when they'll go away, but if we want to try to bring, you know, different people together, then I think that's really, really important. And I think that's one of the one of the valuable things about a book like this.
Mm. You said it before when you're talking about patriarchy and that it's kind of bad for everybody, it's bad for a society, but yeah. You know, a lot of the literature that came out in the last, you know, hello dog, last
my dog. This is my dog, his name is Jiyoung, it's a Korean
very
as well.
Cute, very yeah. Cute. No, but the idea that you know, that patriarchal structures trap men as well as women, they trap yeah. everyone into specific roles that everyone struggles to live up to, and you look at the rates of male mental health issues and of suicide in a country like Australia, and you can see that something has gone really wrong. Absolutely. I wanted to, before, I can see there's some fantastic questions popping up and I'm going to get to them in a moment, but I wanted to ask you one last quick question, which is that we talked, you know, I mentioned it in my introduction and you referred to it as well, that Kim Jiyoung seems to be sort of going mad. She starts to speak in these other voices. She either behaves like a baby or she starts to take on the voice of her mother, which I thought was really interesting, that the only way to advocate for herself was to sort of take the next generation's voice of yeah. herself. But you know, madness is a kind of a really powerful metaphor, and it's a powerful state in literature and storytelling, and often the person who is mad is the only person who's seeing things clearly. And I wondered if that's the case in this novel. Is that the reason why the author might have given us this kind of dissociative state that Kim Jiyoung starts to go into?
I think that's a wonderful interpretation. You know, all books we can interpret differently, but I would agree with that. I can't give you the ending away, because I feel like
if we give you
the ending, I could sort of go into it. But yeah, there's it's really interesting as you read this book. I mean, I was certainly identifying with Kim Jiyoung, even written in that kind of clinical mode. And you kind of start to understand why she might dissociate, you know? So in some ways I hadn't thought about this way, but this book is also, I think it does a really, it makes us think about the ways in which mental health is always, our mental health is dependent on our social context, on where we are and how people treat us. And you know, it's when I teach about race and racism, for instance, which is again, not the same, but you know, all of these isms, they have a material impact on our health, like literally, like our brain waves change, you know, there's trauma brain and so on. So if you think about a whole country or a whole world of women whose brains aren't working at their full capacity because of this kind of normalized systemic sexism, it's a tragedy, isn't it? You know, think about, yeah. So
I think the book captures that very beautifully, even though, as we said, it's got footnotes. There are these beautiful descriptions, very powerful descriptions all the way through the book of what Kim Jiyoung is experiencing in her life. It's also a very searing and very poignant expression of the pain in someone's internal life, the way that these social and political things and movements affect us every day, affect our spirit. And I think that's something that's really wonderful about the book. I've got great questions and I'm conscious of the time, so I'm going to start putting some to you. First question is from Helene, and it's a longer question. She says, is it generally accepted that once women marry, they're no longer taken seriously in the workplace, not offered promotions, etc.? Do women in South Korea have to choose between being a career person or a good wife, mother, daughter-in-law? Is there not adequate childcare? And are mothers expected to teach their own children until they go to school?
Okay, these are excellent questions. Again, I can email me and I can give you lots of great academic articles if you want more. But the answer to most of those questions is, oh my God, I was just looking at the chat and it's disappeared, but is yes, right? So women are still seen as the primary caregiver in the family. So, and also I forgot to mention, oh my goodness. So HSC is really intense here. Imagine that 1,000 times more intense in South Korea. From the minute the kid is like going to, I don't know, nursery school, it's extremely competitive. And mothers basically spend so much time doing so much invisible labor. I think we have that, the tiger mom, but like, you know, in Korea, that is such an important role. And so your worth, I mean, your value as a mother is measured by how well your kids are doing school. So yeah, and generally if you are married, you are gonna not be taken as seriously in the workplace. So there's a way in which women have to really embody the sort of the traits of masculinity to succeed.
Mm-hmm. So Jen, this is a question from Jake, who said he's really enjoyed the talk. He thought it's been really insightful. He said he also has heard about, in relation to this book, that there's been a lot of backlash from Korean men to the book and the film.
Yes.
And it seems like more and more Korean men are speaking out against the most horrific expressions of misogyny. And he mentions a few cases. But he says, do you feel that, just your opinion, do you feel that there's been progress on the more subtle and unseen gender inequalities that take place behind closed doors, such as in the home or the workplace? I know in the book they talk a lot about things that are being legislated against. What do you think? Are things different?
It's hard for me to say because I'm not married to a Korean man. And I don't live in Korea.
12 years, I think. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, I have a dog, right? So he's actually the best partner ever because he doesn't talk then.
That's what I say. It's a whole other interview.
Yeah. It's a joke, Jake. But I think that I think it's probably, you know, in individuals, right? So I'm sure that there are couples in Korea who are watching the film and reading the book together and like men who are having light bulb moments. But I also think that, you know, I think that it's so, this kind of sexism that she's describing is so internalized and systematized. It's so much a part of the culture. I think that usually what happens, not just in Korea, but anywhere, is the legislation happens, but it takes so much longer for people's minds and hearts to kind of shift.
And the author even poses that question in the book. She says, do values shape the law, or does the law shape our values?
Exactly.
Yeah. Another question here from Sarah. She says, with Me Too in mind and the publication as well as the theatrical adaptation of the novel, how did the Burning Sun scandal also affect the awakening of Korean society to its extreme sexism, especially in the last year?
Okay, so again, good question. Those of you who don't know about the Burning Sun scandal, it was huge. It happened in 2019, and in a nutshell, two huge K-pop, male K-pop stars, Seungri and Jung Junyoung from Big Bang, which is a big K-pop group, were indicted on charges of sexual bribery, basically doing all kinds of molka, which I mentioned earlier. And so it caused this huge scandal, and it was scandalous on a number of fronts. So those of you who are K-pop fans know how incredibly regimented K-pop lives are and how surveyed they are. So basically, if you're a K-pop star, you kind of represent Korea on the world stage and in Korean culture. So you're expected to be squeaky clean, like in every respect. And so for this to happen, it was this huge, huge kind of bomb that hit. And as far as I know, and somebody should just chat and correct me because I really don't know the details of how it all went down. I just know that it was this huge thing. From what I heard, the two perpetrators weren't, like, they haven't been thrown in jail or anything. They weren't punished the way that they should have been given the enormity of the charge. So I think a lot of women were quite angry that they got off so easily from, given the severity of the crime. But that's also not surprising, right? Given that, like for instance, with molka, right? Like when people get accused, judges or police officers, they'll say, well, why are you embarrassed? You know, I mean, like you can't put these guys in jail because look, you don't see your face. It's just your ass or your legs or, you know, this kind of very
normalizing.
Minimizing and blaming the victim continues, I think.
A question here from Levon. Has the book ignited the sentiments of women who were initially timid of just accepting their place in Korean society. What do you think?
I think so, yeah. I think a book like this, precisely because it's not like an activist book. You know, I think a lot of women in Korea, because I worked again with some feminists when I was there, there's a lot of women who are feminist, I think, and many of their beliefs don't want to be associated with the angry radical feminists, you know? And so I think a book like this kind of maybe gives them this sort of pause to reflect on their own lives and realize the ways in which actually there's something wrong with this society, you know? And then maybe gives you the courage to go out and protest or have a conversation with your husband, you know? Or maybe educate your daughter differently. You know, there are lots of different ways that you can make a difference, I suppose. Mm.
There's a broad question here from Teresa, and she says, you know, she feels generally, she's written a beautiful little piece that women are thought of women have been thought of as less for a long time, you know, for a very long time, that they weren't allowed to study, they weren't allowed to work. And women are thought of as mothers, and that's seen as the natural state for them to take care of children, but also to work at the same time. And she says, do you think if the approach of men changed, so if men were to help with childcare, for example, would it solve this whole issue about how men and women see each other?
Yes. I think if men changed, the world would look really different. I think if every single man, and again, what do we even mean by man, right? Like, I suppose cis, you know, straight man could spend one day in the body of a woman and see what that felt like, I think, and then they did something about it, I think the world would be a very, very different place. Then I think there would be the chance for actual gender equality on this planet. But it's really hard. I'm not blaming men. It would be really hard. It's the same. If you're a white person in Australia, it's really hard to understand what it feels like to be non-white, you know? Anyone who's in the majority, it's going to be really hard. No matter how well-meaning and how much you want to help, you'll never have the experience, right? And I think that's why books like this are really important, to kind of give you a snapshot and maybe understand a bit. Hmm.
There's a very good question here from somebody who says, is there any religious influence on the role of the idea of the good woman in South Korea?
Well, that's a really good question.
It's
based in Confucianism, which is not a religion, it's a philosophy. But it's interesting that, I mean, I haven't checked the stats, but at the moment, like, there's so many Christians in South Korea. In fact, the largest number of, I can't remember, basically Koreans kind of dominate that sort of missionary role in around the world, right? So, and anyone who is Korean Australian or Korean American or Korean diasporic, you know that your social life revolves around church. So all of us have, you know, most, I shouldn't say all, but many, it's very dominant. So I think it's interesting how those sort of Neo-Confucian ideas about women have translated into sort of Christian expressions. I can't speak to the Buddhist side. But yeah, so it's a great question. Mm. Google Scholar.
Another question here, which is a more personal question for you, from Kate. She says, this is not just a story for South Korea and Western countries. And she wondered if you could talk a little bit about your experience as a woman, both who's lived in America and in Australia, given your Korean background.
Kate, you should just email me and we can have a coffee and I can
go on.
But no, I'm joking, but not. Like, seriously, email me. I think it's a different experience. So really quickly, I guess, in an anecdote, I can tell you, when I was living in Korea for a few years and when I've gone back, I have to tell you, I feel this huge sense of relief because I look like everybody else. You know, I know that's a bit of a racial stereotype, but I can kind of blend in. Whereas in Australia, unless I'm in Strathfield or, you know, Chatswood, I'm basically going to stick out. At Sydney Uni, I get mistaken for a student all the time. You know, like, I stick out. I don't look like an academic. So there's racism that I have to deal with on a daily basis on top of sexism. So there's a kind of, is it, when somebody's mean to me, I'm like, was that a racist thing or was that a sexist thing? You know, or is it just
having a bad day? Like,
it's, yeah, or maybe I'm just having a bad day, you know, maybe my hair isn't right, you know, who knows? But in Korea, it was amazing because the race stuff, I knew that wasn't, because I'm dominant racially there. So, you know, but the sexism was really, really intense. And listening to my friends there talk about the experiences they had, it was just, you know, I felt like, oh my God, here I am complaining about sexism in the US, and that's nothing compared to what they have to go through. Mm-hmm. So yeah, that's just it in a nutshell, but definitely email me and we can chat.
Back on the religious thing, Stella's given us a lovely comment, which is, well, lovely, says in relation to the Unification Church, you see they emphasize a woman's obedience toward their husband in order to achieve peace through marriage. So there's like, it's another way that there's a lot of pressure on women to stay quiet, to do what's required to keep the peace.
Yeah.
As a great question here from Sarah, she says, as female university students, how can we be part of helping to change global society's sexism to one of further equality? What can we do that will make a difference, even a little?
That's a fantastic question, Sarah. I think there are so many things you can do at different levels. So I to my own students, I constantly emphasize the need to reflect on ourselves first, right? And to think about our social circles and our families. I think it's important to participate, you know, in social justice movements. There are ways that we can do that. You can connect with groups that are advocating for social change in all sorts of ways. And I think that kind of activism is extremely important. I also think it's really important, of course, I'm going to say this, to educate yourself and to take courses. I don't know if it's right, but I teach this stuff. So look me up, just Jane Park, Sydney Uni, I'll come up. You know, learning what people have written about, and we study this stuff, you know, how does systemic sexism work? You know, like, how does it perpetuate itself? What does it have to do with issues of race and class and, you know, ability and so on? But I think more than anything, I think it's so important to have these conversations with people in your life and try to change their opinions. I think if you can do that, and then I'm just a real proponent of intimate individual conversations, and then that person going out to talk to other people. So I know that sounds very unsexy and reformist rather than revolutionary. It's probably just because I'm older now, but I think we need to do both together. So
lovely answer. We're almost out of time. We've got time for a few more questions, and one of them here, if I understand it right, is from Sarah, and she says in her mind, why do you think female sexism against women is ingrained in the Far East? And she feels like, is it more ingrained in the Far East than it is maybe in the West, if I understand?
No, actually, I don't think so. So I think it's very easy to say that it's ingrained.
Hard on, but interesting to hear you talk about that.
Yeah, no, that's such a great question. The first thing I think of when I think about what I would call the internalization, you know, of sexism or of patriarchy, and the ways that women hurt other women, right? Because they've taken on the same patriarchal mindset. I think in East Asia, a lot of this is kind of, I keep blaming Confucius, but he was a pretty sexist guy. you know, there's a way in which if your entire identity is based on, like, your value as a person is based on, can you have a male son to perpetuate the family name? Then of course, like the best example of this is the way that the mother-in-law, who has suffered all this stuff from her mother-in-law, will then go and be really mean to her daughter-in-law, right? So the way that female solidarity is erased because of the need to please men, right? And to perpetuate the male line. Does that make sense? So that's a very kind of—
it's almost like hazing. It's like in the army, it's this kind of hierarchical reinforce. It was done to me, so it's gonna be done to you. And therefore it's normal, and it's I won't have to lose my mind over it.
Absolutely. And can I just say, I feel like in the West, I may get into a little bit of trouble for this, but I think that we see this sometimes among second wave feminists, the ways in which they might treat younger feminists, right? So the ways in which, well, I suffered all this, I did all this, and I still succeeded. I've become a full professor, or I've become a CEO. So you need to go through the same thing. They may not articulate that in a conscious way, but unconsciously, they will have taken on all the attributes that we, like if you go, okay, well, what does it mean to be successful? If you stop and think about it, even something very basic, like, sorry, my voice was getting really high, but that's what I was going to get to. You know, this whole kind of idea that to be seen as authoritative as a woman, you need to lower your voice. I mean, when I was 16, I started smoking to lower my voice. not because I was a feminist or anything, but because I didn't want to be seen as this like weak little squeaky voiced Asian girl, you know? So I've cultivated this voice, but the fact that I have to do that, anyway, I got off track, but I hope that makes sense. Those kinds of examples maybe of internalizing.
But it also, it reinforces or reminds us of the idea that all genders, however you identify and describe yourself and live in your life, there needs to be space for you to be proud of who you are. If you have a culture, as you say, where it's not just about giving primacy to men, but also really at the same time, really negating women. You know, you can't have a high voice and you can't be ugly and you can't be overweight and you can't be, you know, too smart. There's some fabulous stuff in the book about, you know, we find smart women very taxing. Right. And you're being very taxing now. You know, it's wonderful stuff, but it's a reminder for you of, as you said, though, maybe that's, you said before, you know, it's not a revolutionary idea, but maybe the idea of how we reform things is to start seeing each other as whole people, as whole humans. And I think the book really does that beautifully. I'm conscious of the time. I want to quickly run through a few things that people have asked, because we can do that quickly, and then put one more question to you. Levon says the experience of the author in the book partly explains the fact that Korea has apparently one of the highest divorce rates in the OECD, which I thought was very brilliant. Yuana asked what type of mental illness did Kim Jiyoung have? And you will have to read the book, because it's kind of, it might be postnatal depression. It might be actually, seemed to me as a mother, seemed to be a kind of a fairly, I don't know, kind of an almost a healthy response to what was going on in her life. But it's not really made clear in the book for that reason. So I wanted to ask, there's another question just here before we go, if everyone's happy to stay with us just for one more moment. Here we go. Yeah, here we go. So it's a question from Stella again. She says, in terms of racism and sexism, Korean women's gender inequality is often heard about in academic work and in the Korean media. So she says she feels like gender inequality is improving, but many migrant women from Southeast Asia who might marry Korean men are suffering, not just gender, but also from racial hierarchies, which you mentioned before about, you know, who you are when you're in Australia and who you are when you're in Korea. And those women are forced to become good wives and good mothers. Is that also an issue in South Korea? This kind of, are there racial divides as well as gender divides that are at play?
Yeah, absolutely. And so it's interesting because, you know, as Stella would know, South Korea sort of has seen itself for a very long time as a racially homogenous, one nation, one blood kind of country, right? And so united and so on. And of course, this is a myth, because how many times has Korea, the peninsula, been colonized? So how can that be? But anyway, this myth of homogeneity has really sort of shifted in the past, 30 so years, as more and more migrant wives, women, have been coming into Korea, to South Korea, to marry mostly, you know, Korean men from the rural areas. But it's interesting because, so Korea has become extremely multicultural. Like, I mean, I think about when I was living there in the 90s, and then every few years I've gone back for my research. It's just become more and more multicultural, which is really lovely to see. Having said that, and it's such a good question, because there's so much racism in Korea, in South Korea, that needs to be addressed. And obviously this book is not addressing that, because she's looking at the experience of, in terms of race, a very dominant, you know, she's a racially dominant, in the racially dominant category. And it's interesting that the migrant women are being expected to be these sort of very traditional, embodied traditional Korean feminine roles, at the same time as Korean women are being chastised for becoming too westernized and too feminist. It's an interesting dynamic, I think, right? And also the fact that the migrant women are coming to Korea from China and again, Southeast Asia primarily, to have children, right? And so it's this idea that, you know, we have a similar thing in China, I mean, in other countries, in Japan, right? Where like women, the more educated they get, they're like, I'm not gonna get married, because why would you wanna get married, because of all this discrimination? And then who sort of then takes their place, right? And become objects of racism and sexism, sometimes from Korean women also. So it's very complicated. It's a fantastic question.
Very quickly before we finish, Isaac says, you know, do past traumas from mother-in-law's relationships affect the way they relate to each other? And you referred to it before, that it's that kind of like what was done to you before, you just continue to repeat. There are fantastic other questions here that we just don't have time to get to because I'm conscious that we've run a little bit over. But I wanted to say, as Dr. Jane Park said, that she is willing to answer your questions. So you will find her. You will find her email address. As she's at the University of Sydney. She is willing to answer extra questions of yours. But I wanted to thank you, fantastic people, tonight. I wish we could see you all. I wish we could all be together. I'm sure we will be soon. But thank you for being here tonight. And also thank you for your fantastic questions. They were so thoughtful and so nuanced. And I'm glad we could get to a lot of them. But I particularly want to thank Dr. Jane Park for her insights and for her sharing her experience with us, both personal and professional. And I want to say that if you've enjoyed tonight's conversation, be sure to keep an eye on the State Library of New South Wales website, because there are lots more fantastic talk events coming up. But for now, I want to say good evening, everyone. Have a lovely rest of your week and stay safe.
Thanks, Michaela. Thank you, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye.